So today I'll be discussing about a different aspect of a digital communication system, and it is known as spread spectrum modulation. In fact, this particular type of communication technology becomes very much popular for the military communication, in which case the transmission of information from the one place to another is very much important. And the security issue is also under consideration. So for example, let me draw the very fundamental block diagram of any communication system. As you know, we have a transmitter and we have a receiver over here, and the purpose of the communication is to allow the information bearing signal to get propagated from the transmitter side to the receiver side, and in between we have channel. Now there could have been different types of channel. As you know, we can have a wired channel, in which case the transmitter and receiver, they are connected by means of some physical device, or you can have wireless channel, in which case they are not physically connected, but by means of air medium, the signal is being propagated from the one end to the other end. So that is a very basic architecture of any communication system. And what happens in case of broadcasting, as you know, there is a single transmitter, and there could have been multiple receivers. For example, if I consider a radio communication, so there is a single transmitter, and the transmitter will generate the information bearing signal, and it can be received by several radio receivers present within the periphery of the communication. On the other hand, apart from this broadcasting, there could have been some secure communication, in which case the communication is meant for a single receiver. That means whenever the transmitter is sending information, it is expected that the information being transmitted from that particular end should be received by the intended receiver and should not be received by someone else. For example, if I consider military communication, whenever the soldiers, they transfer the information, then obviously it is expected that the soldiers from a particular country, so they will share the information amongst themselves. And there is a possibility that within the periphery of their communication, there could have been the soldiers from the different country, from the neighboring country. And sometimes by virtue of some mechanism, they can disrupt the communication between this transmitter and receiver. And to combat this effect, a new type of communication technology has been proposed, and it is known as spread spectrum modulation. So as you understand, this particular modulation scheme will enhance the spectrum of the information bearing signal. So the amount of bandwidth that is required for this spread spectrum modulation is much, much higher than the minimum bandwidth required for the transmission. So here, the notion of this spread spectrum modulation is to protect the information bearing signal. The information bearing signal is being propagated from this end, this transmitter end. And the idea is to protect the information bearing signal to reach at the receiving end. And there could have been some interference signal or jamming signal whose sole purpose is to disrupt the communication between the transmitter and the receiver. Sometimes the jamming signal may try to listen what is being propagated, and accordingly there could have been different types of coding scheme which are widely available, so that this overall communication can be made much more secure. So to understand this one, so let us assume that the information bearing signal is being represented by, suppose the symbols are being represented by BK. So these are nothing but the information bearing signal that you want to transmit from the one end to the other end. Information bearing signal, or rather it is symbol. And suppose they are being represented by a signal which is a function of time, BT. So this is nothing but the information bearing signal. And whenever the signal is being propagated from this end, from this transmitter end to the receiver end, there is a possibility that there could have been some interference signal. Let this interference signal is being represented by some IT, And this information bearing, this particular signal, interference signal, tries to disrupt the communication. So ultimately, at the receiving end, what you are getting is not exactly equal to BT, rather BT plus IT. So obviously, as a matter of fact, the signal that you are going to receive at this particular end is not the exact signal which you have transmitted from the transmitter side. So the entire communication setup must provide some means so that this particular effect could have been combated. And here, the idea is to enhance the minimum bandwidth required for the transmission. For example, if I consider the signal BT, the information bearing signal, and suppose in order to transmit the signal over a channel, suppose the required bandwidth is given by F of B. So FB is the amount of bandwidth which is required to transmit the information from the one end to the other end. Now, whenever some interference signal or jamming signal is present within the channel, then by virtue of some modulation, which we call as spread spectrum modulation, by virtue of some modulation, the bandwidth that is required for the transmission, suppose the bandwidth is being represented by FS, where FS is much, much higher as compared to FB. So you might argue that we are losing the bandwidth efficiency in this particular case, because we can very easily transfer the information from the one end to the other end using a bandwidth of FB. So this is the minimum bandwidth. So let me specify what is meant by FB. This is nothing but the minimum bandwidth required for transmission. Or rather, for normal transmission. That is FP. And here, FS is nothing but the amount of bandwidth, allocated to combat the effect of jamming signal. So this is the purpose. So we can have a jamming signal or interference signal. And to combat the effect of this jamming signal, what we are doing is we are using a bandwidth which is much, much higher than the minimum bandwidth required for the normal transmission. The advantage what we are getting is at the output, at the receiving end, we expect that the effect of the information, I mean, this effect of this interference signal can be completely neglected. Or in other words, we can say that whenever we are making use of this type of communication, then the information bearing signal, that is BT, is being propagated from the transmitter side to the receiver side without being noticed by anyone else. Since the signal, the transmitted signal which you are sending by means of this spread spectrum modulation is having a bandwidth which is much, much higher as compared to the minimum required bandwidth. So one can say that this particular notion of modulation is known as a camouflaging. Why camouflaging? Because you are sending the information from the one end to the other end, but the interference signal, the jamming signal, which is trying to disrupt the communication, does not have any idea regarding the presence of the information bearing signal. In most of the cases, we find that this interference signal or jamming signal can be regarded as a wideband noise signal or a multi-tone signal. Wideband noise, a multi-tone signal. And the signal BT is having a bandwidth which is much, much smaller as compared to the bandwidth of the information bearing signal. I mean, this IT, that is this wideband noise or multi-tone signal. So the idea is to camouflage the information bearing signal from one end to the other end. And this has been accomplished by multiplying the information bearing signal with a code signal, and this code signal is given by CT. This is known as the code signal. So whenever you multiply a signal with another signal in the natural time domain, and obviously in the frequency domain, what happens? The corresponding frequency spectrum is nothing but the convolution between the two signals. So what I mean to say is that suppose we are having an information bearing signal like BT, and this BT is multiplied with another code signal CT in the natural time domain, and ultimately what you are getting is the actually transmitted message signal in the baseband transmission. So in the natural domain, it's nothing but a simple product or multiplication in natural domain or time domain. And this has the effect of having convolution in the frequency domain. So obviously in the frequency domain, one can write that M of F, this is nothing but the convolution between the two signals, BF and CF. If I assume that the BF is the frequency representation of BT and CF is the frequency response of CT, then it gives rise to convolution in the frequency domain. Now, what we have already mentioned, that the message signal which you are going to transmit, MF, must be having a much, much higher bandwidth as compared to BF. Then obviously, since it's nothing but a convolution, so in case of a convolution, the overall bandwidth is being governed by the bandwidth of the signal, which is more. So here, if CF is having a higher bandwidth, I can represent by means of symbol only. If the bandwidth, let this be represented by FC, if this FC is greater than or much, much greater than FB, then FM, that is the bandwidth of the message signal or transmitted signal, that is MF, is basically approximately equal to F of C. That is the property of the convolution, that if we have two different signals having different bandwidth, and if the corresponding bandwidths are having order difference, for example, if FB is having a bandwidth of in the range of say few tens of kilohertz or hundreds of kilohertz, and on the other hand, if CF is having a bandwidth of say hundreds of megahertz or so, then if I convolve these two signals in the frequency domain, then the convolution result, that is MF, will be having a bandwidth which is essentially governed by the higher bandwidth. That means F of M, that is the bandwidth of the message signal, can be represented or can be approximated by the bandwidth of the signal CF, that is equal to F of C. And since F of C is much, much greater than F of B, so we can say that F of M is also much, much greater than F of B. But how to ensure that F of C is much, much greater than F of B? Because as you know, I have already mentioned that BT is nothing but the representation of the signal in the natural time domain. For example, if BK looks something like that, suppose BK, that is the information bearing symbol, suppose BK is represented by say 0, 1, 1, 0, like this. Suppose let me consider four such symbols, 0, 1, 1, and 0. Then the corresponding signal BT in the natural time domain can be represented like this. So if I consider say polar non-return to zero kind of representation, then this can be represented by, say for zero, it is like having a amplitude of say minus A, and for one, it will be having an amplitude of plus A. So this is the representation of the signal BT. So this is plus A. So this is the representation. So obviously, there are a number of symbols. So accordingly, you have to draw the corresponding waveform for PT. Now, as you understand, if I consider a single bit, for example, so one is being represented by a pulse like this. Say amplitude equal to plus A, and suppose this duration is given by TP, that is a bit duration. And as you know, if I perform the frequency domain representation, if I perform the corresponding Fourier analysis of this particular pulse waveform, you will see that the corresponding waveform is having a shape of a sine function, and for which the null to null bandwidth is essentially governed by 1 upon TB. So this null to null bandwidth, if I consider this bandwidth, so this is in the frequency domain, so this is essentially governed by, so if we have 1 upon TB over here, 1 upon TB over here, so it will be 2 upon TB. So what we can say is this bandwidth is inversely proportional to this bit duration. So if the bit duration is small, then this bandwidth will be more, and vice versa. So that is the scenario for the information varying signal, that is V of T. Now, what we have already stated is that the code signal CT is having a bandwidth F of C, which is much, much higher than F of B. So considering this fact, for the code signal, this code duration should be small, because since the bandwidth of the code signal, I mean, if I consider F of C, since F of C is much, much greater than F of B, and therefore it suggests that T of C, which is the duration of a code signal, is much, much less as compared to T of B. So that condition has to be satisfied. So we have to design a particular type of code signal, and this code signal will be used to modulate the information bearing signal, and accordingly, this modulated version, this multiplied version, will be transmitted to the channel. Now, before saying anything further, let us try to understand the most popular type of the code signal, which has been used over the years in case of split spectrum modulation. And this type of code signal is known as pseudo noise sequence. Pseudo noise sequence, or pseudo noise code, or in short, PN sequence. Or PN code. Now, obviously, I'll refer why it is meant by, or why it is called like a pseudo noise function or pseudo noise sequence. Now, before going into that, let us try to understand what is meant by a pseudo noise sequence or what is meant by a PN sequence. So, in fact, it is nothing but a periodic random binary wave. It's periodic random binary wave, and that is normally generated by means of feedback shift register. So what do you mean by that? So we should have a feedback. So this is generated by feedback shift register. So obviously we should have a number of flip-flops. Since we are talking about the shift register, so we should have a number of flip-flops, and which are connected like this. Suppose let us have M number of flip-flops, which are connected in this way. Suppose this is FF1, that is flip-flop 1. This is second flip-flop, that is flip-flop 2. This is third flip-flop, that is flip-flop 3. And ultimately, we have, say, mth flip-flop, that is FFM. And all of them are being governed by a single clock signal. So they are synchronized in nature. So we should have a single clock signal, which is being fed to each of the flip-flops. So this is nothing but the clock signal, CLK. And output of the flip-flop 1 is connected to flip-flop 2. And output of the flip-flop 2 is connected to the input of flip-flop 3, and so on. So this is the architecture of a shift register. We have M number of flip-flops, and we have a logic circuit over here. And the logic circuit will take the corresponding input. So this is the logic circuit, and it will take the corresponding input from the output of the flip-flops. So it was something like that. So flip flop one, flip flop two, up to say flip flop M. So let me just extend that part. So logic circuit will accept the input from the output of the flip-flops, and ultimately the logic circuit will generate some Boolean function, and this Boolean function is once again being fed at the input of the first flip-flop. So ultimately there are a number of multi-connected loops. So we have multiple loops. So these loops are interconnected. So we have a feedback kind of thing. So that's what is known as a feedback shift register. The output of the flip-flops are being fed to the input of the logic circuit, and then the logic circuit will compute some Boolean function, and this Boolean function is being fed to the input of the first flip-flop. So we have a number of loops which are being present. So that's why it is known as a feedback shift register. And the output of the last flip-flop, that is flip-flop M, will give you what is known as a pseudo noise sequence or PN sequence. Now, in case when the logic circuit that is used to compute the Boolean function, whenever it consists of only modulo two adders, so in which case it is known as linear feedback shift register. So in case the logic circuit involves only modulo two adders, nothing else, so whenever the output of these flip-flops are being combined in a modulo two fashion, then it is known as linear feedback shift register, or in short LFSR, linear feedback shift register. Or LFSR. And accordingly, if I have m number of such flip-flops in this particular architecture, so there could have been altogether 2 to the power m number of possible states, because each flip-flop can assume either a value of 0 or 1. So flip-flop is a single bit containing element, so it can either contain a bit value equal to 0 or a bit value equal to 1. So since there are m number of such flip-flops, so there could have been altogether 2 to the power m number of possible states. Now, if the logic circuit involves only modulo 2 adders, so in which case it is known as a linear feedback shift register, then obviously the all 0 state is excluded, because if all the flip-flops output are equal to 0, then whenever you feed those output to a logic circuit, the logic circuit output will become 0, and ultimately all the flip-flops will remain in a particular state, that is all 0 state. So this all 0 state is excluded, and if I exclude that state, then we have 2 to the power m minus 1 number of state, and this is the maximum length of the sequence. So the maximum length of the sequence, so that is the maximum length of the sequence, of this PN sequence, is given by two to the power m minus 1. Because all zero state is excluded, so if I have 4 flip-flops, so 15 such states are valid. One state is excluded, one state is prohibited, because all zero state is prohibited. You can go from 0001 to all 1. So all these 15 states are permissible, but the all zero state is not permissible. So if I have in general m number of such flip-flops in that particular architecture, in that linear feedback shift register, so maximum length of the sequence could have been 2 to the power m minus 1, and in which case the pseudo noise sequence is known as the maximum length sequence, or m sequence. So under this condition, it is known as m sequence, or maximum length sequence, in which case the length of the sequence is given by 2 to the power m minus 1. So the period for m sequence, the period equal to 2 to the power m minus 1. And obviously, whether in a particular linear feedback shift register generates m sequence or not, that is actually governed by the connection. So depending upon the connection from which terminal you are taking the feedback, whether you are taking the feedback from the first and second, or whether from the first and the third, or whether from the fourth and the third. So depending upon that connection, what you are feeding to the input of the logic circuit, a particular maximum length sequence, I mean particular pseudonymized sequence can result a maximum length sequence or not. So let me just explain this thing in much more detail, taking into account, say, a circuit like this. Suppose we do have three such flip-flops. So this is flip-flop one. This one is flip-flop two. And this one is flip-flop three. And we do have a logic circuit over here. Output of the flip-flop one is being fed to the input of the flip-flop two. And input of the then we have a connection like this. Output of the flip-flop 3 is being fed to the logic circuit. And suppose we do have another connection from this particular end. And this is the logic circuit, as we have already mentioned. And once again, the Boolean function, which has been computed by the logic circuit, is being fed at the input of the flip-flop one. And we have a clock signal over here. This is the clock signal, so that all the flip-flops are synchronized. And the output of the flip-flop is nothing but the corresponding pseudonymized sequence or PN sequence. Now let us check whether this particular arrangement generates an M sequence or not. So to start with, let us assume that initially, so as I have already mentioned, that 000 state is not at all a permissible one. So let us start with 100 state. Suppose initially, this, let me write down the, I mean, so this is flip-flop one, flip-flop two, flip-flop three. Suppose initial state is, for example, this is 100. This is the initial state. Then what happens? In the next clock cycle, this flip-flop one output will become the output for flip-flop two. So this one will come over here, and this zero will come over here. So it will be better if I just reduce the size over here. So one over here and zero over here. What will be the input of flip-flop one? So it will accept flip-flop 1 and flip-flop 3. So this logic circuit, the corresponding Boolean function, if I consider this Boolean function to be x, then this x can be represented as x is nothing but flip-flop 1, the output of flip-flop 1, and the corresponding XOR function with flip-flop 3. So modulo 2 addition. So 1 and 0, so the result will be 1. So in the next cycle, this one will come over here, and this one will come over here. And x value at this instant is nothing but the XOR of these two, 1 and 0. So 1 second, 1. In the next cycle, this one will come over here, and this one will come over here. And this 1 and 1, if you find out the corresponding XOR operation, exclusive OR operation, it will give you 0. Next, 0 will come over here and 1 will come over here, and 0 and 1 will give you 1. The next cycle, this 1 will come over here, 0 will come over here, and 1 and 1 will give you 0. Next, this 0 will come over here, 1 will come over here, and 0 and 0 will give you 0. Next, what happens if you consider the next instant? Then 0 will come over here, this 0 will come over here, and 0 and 1 will give you 1. So which is nothing but the repetition of this stage. So we have started with 100 and you have exploited all the possible combinations except 000. So if you have 3 bits like 0, 0 and 0, so you can have altogether 8 possibilities. 000, 001 up to 111. So you have altogether 8 possibilities. Now if I exclude the 000 combination, so you have only 7 possibilities. Now if you start from 100, if you start from 100, then the next state is 110, then the next one is 111, then 011, then 101, then 010, 001. And then this is the breakpoints. In fact, this is the end of one period. And once again, the same thing will be repeated. So all the 7 states have been exploited. Might be in a different order. It's not like that after 001, the next step will be 010. After 001, the next step is 100. And after 100, the next step is 110. And after 110, the next step is 111. And then the next step is 011. So the way the states are being available, so this is completely random. So that's why it is known as a pseudo random sequence, a pseudo noise sequence. So for example, if I consider, for example, let me assume that apart from this, we do have another connection over here. And let us check whether this can produce a maximum length sequence or not. So let me just modify the previous circuit. Flip-flop 1, flip-flop 2, flip-flop 3. And let us start with the same combination, that is 100. And let us check whether all these 7 states as obtained with the first case, whether this is also available with the modified architecture. So in the modified architecture, what modification we have done? We have taken the input from each of the 3 flip-flops. So logic circuit now, if I consider the new X, or let this be Y, let this be Y for this new combination. So this Y is given by the XOR of this 3 flip-flop output, that is flip-flop 1, flip-flop 2, and flip-flop 3. So let's start with 100. So what will be the next value? So 1 will come over here, 0 will come over here, and if you find out the XOR operation, it will be 1. Then this 1 will come over here, 1 will come over here, and you have 0. Then the 0 will come over here, 1 will come over here, and you have 0. And then the 0 will come over here, 0 will come over here, and it will be 1. So now the repetition starts. Just check. Last time we have exploited all the 7 states. And this time only 4 states are exploited, but the rest are not exploited. You just try to understand the difference. Here all the 7 states, 001, 2111, all the 7 states are exploited and they are available, but in different order. But however, if I have another connection from this point, then you see that out of 7 states, only 4 states are being present. 100, 110, 011, and 001. After 001, the next step is 100. And then the same thing will get repeated. So the first sequence which you have got using 2 connections like FF1 and FF3, this is known as, I mean, the corresponding output corresponding PN sequence is known as a maximum length sequence. However, for the last one, for the second one, in which case we have additional connection from the flip flop 2, this is not a PN, this is not an M sequence. So this one, so the PN sequence is nothing but this. So if I consider this M sequence, so M sequence is nothing but the output of the flip flop 3. So I can write like 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1. So the period is 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So M sequence is having a period of 7. Or PN sequence is having a period of 7. So that's it is known as an M sequence or maximal length sequence. However, for this PN sequence, this is also pseudo-random sequence, pseudo-noise sequence. But for this sequence, the corresponding period is equal to 4 only, 0, 0, 1, 1. And then one second, it will get repeated, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, and so on. So automatically, this sequence, which you have got with the connection from all these three, flip-flop 1, flip-flop 2, and flip-flop 3, this is not an M sequence. Rather, it's a PN sequence, simple pseudo-noise sequence. Now, let us try to investigate this problem with different architecture, having, say, 5 flip-flops. Suppose we do have 5 flip-flops like this. First, second, third, fourth, and fifth. So these are the 5 flip-flops. So let me write like 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And suppose the logic circuit, so obviously the output of 1 will go to the input of 2, and output of 2 will go to the input of 3, and so on. And we have a logic circuit over here. And suppose this logic circuit will take the output from, the output from flip-flop 2 and flip-flop 5 are being fed to the input of the logic circuit. And the Boolean function, which is being computed by the logic circuit, is being provided to the input of the flip-flop 1. So for this particular combination, let us start with a combination like, say, initially, let us have, this is the initial state, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. And let us check whether all 31 possible states are being available with this particular arrangement or not. Because in this case, we have M is equal to 5. Since M is equal to 5, so you can have the maximum period or maximum length of the sequence could have been 2 to the power 5 minus 1, that is equal to 31. 2 to the power 5 minus 1, that is equal to 31. Now let us check whether all 31 states are available with this particular arrangement or not. So obviously, let me just mark these two points, the second and fifth. So always we have to find out the XOR between these two, second and fifth. So let me mark on the top of these two bits. So 1, 4, 0. So automatically I can directly write these four bits and this will become 0. Then 0, 1, 0, 0, and 1 and 0. So it will become 1. Then 1, 0, 1, 0, 0. Then you have 0, 1, 0, 1. 1 and 0 will give you 1. Then 1, 0, 1, 0. And it will give you 1. 1, 1, 0, 1. This will give you 1. Then 1, 1, 1, 0. And 1 and 1 will give you 0. 0, 1, 1, 1. 1, 0 will give you 1. Then 1, 0, 1, 1. 0 and 1 will give you 1. Then 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, and 1 and 1 will give you 0. Then the next step is 0, 1, 1, 0, it will be 0. After that, we have 0, 0, 1, 1, and we do have 0 over here. Then 0, 0, 0, 1. And we do have 1 and 0 will give you 1. So let me mark on the top of it so that there is no mistake. So in fact, we are taking the connection from these two different flip-flops, second and fifth. Then this 1, 0, 0, 0 will come over here, and 0 and 1 will give you 1. Then 1, 1, 0, 0, and this will give you 1. Then 1, 1, 1, 0, 1 and 0 will give you 1. Then 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 and 0 will give you 1. Then we have 4, 1, and this 0. Then you have 0, 1, 1, 1. We have 0 over here. Then 0, 0, 1, 1. We do have 1 over here. Then 1, 0, 0, 1. We have 1 over here. Then 1, 1, 0, 0. This will give you 0. And then 0, 1, 1, 0. 1 and 0 will give you 1. Then let me write down the next step. In the next step, we have 1, 0, 1, 1. And 0 and 0 will give you 0. Once again, these two are taken into consideration, the second and the fifth. This and this. Then you have 0, 1, 0, 1. 1 on 0 will give you, 1 and 1 will give you 0. Then you do have 0, 0, 1, 0. And 0 and 1 will give you 1. And then we have 1, 0, 0, 1. 0 and 0 will give you 0. Then 0, 1. 0, 0, 1 and 1 will give you 0. Then 0, 0, 1, 0. We have 0 over here. And then 0, 0, 0, 1. We have 0. And then 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. So once again, it is repeated. So at this particular point, all the 31 states are exploited, and then we have the repetition from this point. So let us check whether all the 31 states are available or not. So let me start from this point. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24. 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31. So all 31 states are being exploited. And ultimately, we have got what is known as the maximum length sequence or PN sequence in this particular case. So now if you just find out the corresponding value of the PN sequence, I mean the corresponding sequence, then the sequence can be obtained from the output of any of the flip-flops, but it is customary to take the output from the last flip-flop, that is the flip-flop number 5. So if I just find out the corresponding patterns of zeros and ones from this particular column, we'll be getting what is known as the maximal length sequence. So for this particular case, the corresponding M sequence of length 31 of length 31 or period 31 is given by, so you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 0. To start with 4, 0. 1, 2, 3, 4, 0. Then you have 1, 0, 1, 0. 4, 0, then 1, 0, 1, 0. Then 3, 1, 0. 3, 1, 0. Then you have 2, 1, 3, 0. Then you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, and 2, 0. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, and 2, 0. 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. Lastly, we have 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. Let us check whether 31 bits are present or not. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31. So 31 bits are present. So this is the M sequence of length 31. In fact, you can take the connection from any of the flip-flops. You can also take it from the first flip-flop, from the second flip-flop, from the third flip-flop, or from the fourth flip-flop. We'll be getting the same pattern, but in fact, it is shifted. If you take it from the output of the fourth flip-flop, it will be shifted by 1 bit. Otherwise, the pattern will be the same. So the length is 31. Now, if you check the number of ones and number of zeros present within the M sequence, you'll see that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 ones are present. And 15 zeros are present and 16 ones are present. So within a length of 31, we have 15 zeros and 16 ones. That is the scenario for a length 31 M sequence. Now, if you go back to our first M sequence, which we have got for three flip-flops, using three flip-flops, here you see that we have 3 zeros and 4 ones. And that is a property which is known as the balance property of this maximal length sequence. The balance property says that the number of ones in any M sequence is always one more than the number of zeros. So since the length of the M sequence is always odd number, because it is in the order of like 2 to the power m minus 1. So the length of the M sequence, 2 to the power m minus 1 for any m greater than 2 or 3. So 2 to the power m minus 1. So obviously, this number is odd. So within this 2 to the power m minus 1, there is a distribution of zeros and ones, and the number of ones is always one more than the number of zeros. So if m is equal to 4, so then you have the length of the M sequence to be 15, 2 to the power 4 minus 1. Then you have 8 ones and 7 zeros. For M is equal to 5, you have an M sequence of length 31. Then you have 16 ones and 15 zeros. And if you have M is equal to, say, 6, then you have a length of 63. And out of 63 bits, you'll see that 32 ones and 31 zeros. So always the number of ones is one more than the number of zeros, and that is known as the balance property. So this is known as the balance property of the M sequence. And which is this balance property says that this particular sequence, this M sequence, balance property. And this balance property says that it looks exactly like a truly random binary wave. So if I consider a truly random binary wave, in which case the occurrence of zeros and ones are equiprobable, that means in any particular bit duration from 0 to TB, the corresponding bit can be either 0 or 1. So that's what is known as truly random binary OF. So in fact, if I consider a length of say n, then since the probability of having zeros and ones being the same, and that is equal to half, so out of n bits, we can have n by 2 number of zeros and n by 2 number of ones, since they are equiprobable. For truly random binary OF, since the occurrence of zeros and ones are equiprobable, and that is equal to 0.5, so if I have n number of bits in a truly random binary OF, then out of n bits, n by 2 bits are 0 and rest n by 2 bits are 1. So here also you'll see that it is almost the same, because it cannot be equal, because the length equal to even odd here. So that's why the difference is only 1. The number of 1 is 1 more than the number of zeros. So that is known as a balance property. Then another property which is known as the run property. So what do you mean by run? Run means the occurrence of a single bit. So if I consider here, you'll see that a single bit like 1, it is present successively. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 5 ones are here. So this we can regard as a run of 1 of length 5. A run of 1 of length 5. So run means the appearance of a single bit multiple number of times without any break. So here we have 5 such ones without any break. Similarly, you have 4 such zeros without any break. So we can say that it's a run of 1 of length 5. It's a run of 0 of length 4. Then you see a run of 1 of length 3. Run of 0 of length 3. So I think it will be better if I use a different color to identify the corresponding runs. So run of 1 of length 5, then you have a run of 0 of length 4, then run of 1 of length 3, and run of 0 of length 3, and then we have run of 1 of length 2, and run of 1 of length, run of 0 of length 2, like this. We have two zeros. And then we have single appearance of zeros and ones. So that can be regarded as a run of 1 of length 1. So it will be better if I mark it by means of a single dot. So run of 1 of length 1, run of 0 of length 1, run of 1 of length 1, run of 0 of length 1. Run of 0 of length 1, run of 0 of length 1, run of 1 of length 1, run of 1 of length 1. So what we can say from this particular M sequence of length 31, so there is a single run of 1 of length 5. There is a single run of 1s. There is a single run of 1s of length 5. There is a single run of zeros of length 4. There is a single run of 1s of length 3, and there is a single run of zeros of length 3. There are 2 runs of 1s and 2 runs of zeros, each of length 2. And there are 4 runs of 1s and 4 runs of zeros, each of length 1. So let me repeat once again. This run property, it says that if I consider a maximal length sequence of length 31, so we find that when m is equal to 5, we find that there is a single run of 1s, single run of 1s of length 5. So I think it will be better if I write it down. So what we find is, we have a single run of 1s of length 5. We have a single run of zeros of length 4. We have a single run of ones. And zeros, each of length 3. And then you find four runs of 1. And 0 each of I missed one point, so I have to introduce that first. So up to length 3 I have done. Then we have two runs. Two runs of ones and two runs of zeros, each of length 2. And then ultimately, four runs of ones and four runs of zeros. Each of length 4. So as you can find, so this is known as the run property. As you can find over here, there's a single run of ones of length 5, this one. There's a single run of zeros of length 4, this one. Single run of ones and single run of zeros, each of length 3. Then two runs of ones and two runs of zeros, each of length 2. 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1. And then ultimately four runs of ones and four runs of zeros. Oh, each of length 1. It should be 1. It's not length 4. Four runs of zeros and four runs of ones, each of length 1. Four runs of ones and four runs of zeros, each of length 1. This single appearance, 1, then 0, 1, then 0, 0. So whenever they are present, in isolation, so this is known as a run of 1 of length 1, run of 0 of length 1. So in this way, this entire thing is known as a run property. So I have just explained the run property for a named sequence of length 31. So this is known as a run property. Similarly, you can derive or you can generalize the run property for any m sequence of length 2 to the power m minus 1. So if I consider any m sequence of length 2 to the power m minus 1, so then you find that a single run of ones of length m, there'll be single run of zeros of length m minus 1, there'll be single run of ones and single run of zeros each of length m minus 2, there will be two runs of ones and two runs of zeros each of length m minus 3, and so on. So in this way, you have to define the run property. So just by observing the property of this M sequence, a pseudonoise sequence, what you can find is, if I have a length of say 2 to the power m minus 1, then out of this 2 to the power m minus 1 number of bits, there are 2 to the power m minus 1 by 2 minus 1, and the ceiling operation of that number of ones and rest number of zeros. For example, if I have say 31 to be the length of the M sequence, then out of these 31 bits, we have 16 ones and 15 zeros. And the appearances of the zeros and ones, that is completely random. So that's why it is known as a random sequence, a noise sequence. Because you know that within a length of 31, there could have been 16 ones and 15 zeros, but how these zeros and ones are present within this particular pattern, that is completely unknown. So as I've already told you, just like a truly random binary wave, the appearances of zeros and ones, the corresponding probabilities being the same, 50% out of 31, we have 16 ones and 15 zeros. So close to 50%. If you increase the length of the M sequence, say from 31 to 63, say 63 to 255, or even large, you'll see that even for length of say 1023, you'll see that there you have 512 number of ones and 511 number of zeros. So the corresponding probability of having ones and zeros are almost same, that is 0.5. So this particular sequence, this M sequence, shows the behavior of a truly random binary wave. So without knowing the architecture from which this particular M sequence is being generated, if you do not have any idea regarding this architecture, then for an outsider, this M sequence will look like a random sequence or noise sequence. But if you know the architecture, if you know the feedback number of such flip-flops and how are they connected, then you can very easily identify the corresponding pattern. So if you know the architecture, then it is not at all a noise to you. But if you do not know the architecture, for an outsider, it looks like a random sequence. So that's what is known as a pseudo-noise sequence, a pseudo-random sequence. Although random, but if you know the architecture, it is no longer random. And this property of pseudo-noise sequence, or this property of M sequence, is popularly employed in split spectrum modulation. So whenever, I have already mentioned in the beginning of this class, that we have a information bearing signal, that is B of T, and then this B of T is being modulated by means of a code signal CT, and in fact, popularly used code is a pseudo-noise sequence, that is this M sequence, and people have extensively used this M sequence, and nowadays there are different modifications over the traditionally used M sequence. We have different codes like Kasami sequence and some Gold sequence, so there would have been a different types of codes which are popularly employed nowadays. We have Waltz code for this particular purpose. So we have plenty of new codes are available right now. But to start with, people initially have started with the idea of this maximal length sequence or M sequence. Now the message signal that you are sending through the channel in case of baseband transmission is nothing but the M of T. So if I consider the transmitter side, so in the transmitter side, we have a simple multiplier. One of the input to the multiplier is your information bearing signal, that is BT. And the other input is nothing but the code signal, CT. And one such popularly employed code has been discussed so far, which is known as the maximal length sequence or pseudo-random code. And the output over here is empty. So that is the transmitter model. Now let us assume that we have a message signal like this. For example, we do have a message signal like 0 and then 1. So this is the message signal. So 0 is being represented by minus 1 or minus A, and 1 is being represented by say plus A. So this is the message signal, that is B of T, which is having two different levels, minus A for transmitting 0 and plus A for transmitting 1. So BT here, 0, 1. It corresponds to symbol 0 and symbol 1. And suppose we are using a 7 length PN sequence for this particular purpose, and we have already derived this one. Suppose this one is given by 0, 0. 1 1 1 0 1 0 0 1 1 1 0 1. So M sequence that we are going to employ over here is 0 0 1 1 1 0 1. Just use that part. 00110, this is a code signal which we are going to multiply in the modulator. And obviously the bit duration for the information bearing signal, that is TB, which is much, much higher as compared to the chip duration of the code signal. So this is the bit duration, that is TB. And chip duration must be smaller as compared to that, so that the bandwidth of the resultant signal is high. So here, the signal is 00111101. That is the code signal. So for the code signal, I can write like this. It can be drawn like this, in fact. So let it be like 00. Then we have 111. Then we have 0. Then we have 1. So this is the representation for the code signal CT. So when this is multiplied, this BT is multiplied with CT, and we are getting a new signal known as MT. Then how does this MT look like? Let us check how does it look like, this M of T. So let me just show it for a single bit only. And before that, let me mark the corresponding chip duration. So this is the total bit duration, that is equal to 7 times of TC, and that is equal to TB. So this one is TC, the chip duration, which is much, much small as compared to the bit duration. So therefore, if you go on calculating the frequency response of this particular wave, you'll see that the signal CT is having higher frequency component as compared to the signal BT. So therefore, the bandwidth required for transmitting the signal CT is much, much high as compared to transmitting the signal BT. Now, what we are transmitting? We are transmitting the symbol MT. Then how does this MT look like? Let's just check how does it look like, M of T, that is the message signal which you are going to transmit. So actually we are multiplying this BT with CT. So if I just observe the first bit duration, then it will look something like that. In fact, this entire thing will be multiplied with minus A. So it will get inverted, and it will look something like that. So this is the message signal, M of T, which can be regarded as BT multiplied with CT. So if you find out the corresponding Fourier transform of this signal, you'll see that the minimum bandwidth required for transmitting this information is much, much higher as compared to transmitting BT only. So this is the scenario, what is being done at the transmitter end. And if I go into the channel. So as you know, in the channel, this information bearing signal is being protected by virtue of space spectrum modulation. And in the channel, we can have some jamming signal in the form of IT. And this signal is empty. And ultimately in the channel, what we have, the received signal RT, that can be represented as the message signal MT plus I of T. So this operation takes place in the channel where some interference signal or jamming signal is being pushed into the channel so as to disrupt the communication from the transmitter to the receiver. Now, what is done in the receiving end? In the receiving end, we have to perform the reverse operation. So initially, we have got the signal R of T at the input of the receiver. And this R of T is being provided at the input of a multiplier. And this multiplier, the other input of the multiplier, is provided with the locally generated code signal. So in this particular case, suppose a locally generated PN sequence or M sequence is being provided, and this is known as CT. And this CT at the receiver end and the CT in the transmitter end, so they are properly lined up. So they are in proper synchronization. And what we are getting over here, suppose let me call this signal as, let it be VT. So what we are getting in the form of VT, so as you know, R of T is given by MT plus IT, and M of T is nothing but VT into CT plus IT. So V of T is nothing but R of T into C of T. So it is BT into CT plus IT, that is inform your interference signal. It's multiplied with CT. Then we have BT into C squared T plus IT into CT. Now the parameter C squared is very important. What we find from this expression, CT will look something like that. Whenever the zero is being represented, that can be sent through a pulse of amplitude, say minus one, and one is being represented by means of sending a pulse of amplitude plus one. So CT basically toggles between two levels, plus minus one. So if I consider the signal amplitude for CT, so it is either plus one for sending one or minus one for sending zero. So the value of C squared T is always one, irrespective of the bit pattern present. So C squared T is equal to one for all T. That is true. So whenever we got like BT into C squared T, so that can be written like this, V of T can be written like BT plus CT into IT. Now let us try to identify the frequency component present within these two additive components. Now the output of the multiplier at the receiving end is composed of two different components. One is BT, that is the actually transmitted information bearing signal, that is B of T, and which resembles the corresponding information bearing symbol, that is B of K. And our basic objective is to protect the signal BT from any external perturbations, from any externally generated noise. So we have got BT as one of the component of VT. And apart from that, we do have the second component, which is known as CT into IT. Now, as you know, BT is having a frequency component, which is much, much smaller. And that depends upon the pulse duration, that is TV. Now, what about CT into IT? IT is an interference signal, a jamming signal, which is normally wideband, a multi-tone signal. And whenever this is multiplied with another code signal CT, and which is itself having a very high bandwidth, and even if the code duration, if the length of the PN sequence is large for a particular TV, then obviously, if the length is high, like say, if I increase the length from say 31 to 63, 63 to say 127, 127 to 255, so as you are increasing the length, or as you are increasing the period of the PN sequence or M sequence, the corresponding bandwidth is also getting enhanced. So within the component CT into IT, we have two high frequency signal. One is CT the code signal, and second one is the IT, that is the interference signal or jamming signal. So CT into IT will be having a bandwidth which is much, much higher as compared to the bandwidth of BT. So within the signals V of T, we do have two different components. One is the BT, that is the desired signal which you want to detect. And the second one is the interference signal. And this interference signal is spreaded by virtue of this code signal, a CT. So one of the signal is having a low frequency component, and one of the signal is having a high frequency component. So to segregate them, the most fundamental circuit diagram what we can use is a simple low pass filter. This low pass filter can filter out the high frequency component, and it can easily detect the low frequency component. And this low pass filtering operation could have been implemented by means of an integrator. And this integrator will evaluate the area under the curve between 0 to TB. And the value, resultant value, is compared with respect to 0. Suppose the resultant value is equal given by V. And depending upon the value of V, there could have been two different decisions. So decide in favor of one if V is greater than 0, or if V is less than 0, then we have to decide in favor of 0. Decide 0 if V is less than 0. So since we have this low pass filter in the form of an integrator, so it will compute the area under the curve, and this entire integration is computed over a duration of BT, or a single duration of bit, that is T of B. And then the value is compared with respect to threshold, and this threshold here is equal to 0. So if anything is greater than 0, we will decide that the actually transmitted information within BT was 1. And if the value is less than 0, then we will decide in favor of 0. So our purpose of camouflaging the information bearing signal by increasing its transmission bandwidth to a much higher value can be accomplished by using this code signal as a modulating element. So because of the presence of the code signal C of T, what does it do? This code signal will spread the bandwidth of the information bearing signal at the transmitter end. So the information bearing signal BT is having a lower bandwidth, and this bandwidth is being enhanced by the code signal. So the minimum bandwidth required for the transmission is kept at a very high value, so that it can easily blend into the background and no one else can track that the signal is being transmitted by virtue of this BT into CT combination. So the signal CT enhances or spreads the spectrum. So that's why the name spread spectrum modulation. It spreads, it increases the minimum bandwidth of BT. It increases the bandwidth requirement of BT or message signal to a very high value during its transmission. And that effect can be reverted back at the receiving end by multiplying the received signal RT with the same code signal which we have used in the transmitter side. So this CT, which is used in the receiver end, that must be synchronized in the transmitter side. So this receiver must be having the prior knowledge what about the code signal which is being transmitted from the transmitter end. The corresponding pattern and the time synchronization is also important. So the architecture of the LFSR, what was the pattern? In fact, from a particular LFSR, we can develop different such M sequence. It's not that M sequence is unique. So for a 31 length M sequence, if I consider 31 length PN sequence, so there could have been more than one such M sequence. And that is basically governed by the architecture of the linear feedback shift register. So the receiver must be having a very good knowledge, sound knowledge about the length of the PN sequence. What was the length? Whether it is 31 or 63 or 127 or 255. So that has to be known. And which particular M sequence is being used? So if you open any book, you'll see that there could have been 4 to 5 M sequence, each of having length 31. So all of them will satisfy the property. All of them will satisfy the run property. All of them will satisfy the balance property. But this is not a single, this is not a unique sequence. What we have got, this sequence, this 31 length M sequence. So this is an example. So there could have been more than one such M sequence of length 31, which will satisfy these properties, run property and the balance property. So receiver must be knowing which particular M sequence you are sending, using which particular LFSR architecture. That has to be known to the receiver. And moreover, the timing synchronization is also important. That whenever, what is the starting point of the port signal? What is the end point? So if I assume that at the transmitter end and at the receiver end, this CT, they are properly lined up, then the dispatching operation is being carried out within this multiplier block. So this acts basically like a demodulator. So this one is a modulator. It will modulate the signal BT by virtue of CT. And the effect of modulation is reverted back at the receiver end by means of this demodulator. It will perform just the reverse operation. What was the input? The input was BT into CT, which is a spreaded version, enhanced version, which is for which the bandwidth is much, much larger as compared to BT. If I consider the bandwidth of BT, and if I consider the bandwidth of BT into CT, you'll see that the bandwidth of BT into CT is much, much higher as compared to the bandwidth of BT. So this BT into CT, this particular signal, is a spreaded signal for which the bandwidth is much, much larger. So in the demodulator, the dispreading operation is done. From BT into CT, what we are getting is B of T only by multiplying this BT into CT with another CT. So CT into CT, that is C squared T, will give you one always. Therefore, from BT into CT, we are getting back BT. So this code signal will perform the spreading operation, bandwidth spreading, spectrum spreading in the transmitter side. And it will perform the reverse operation, that is dispatching operation, at the receiver side. And moreover, while performing the dispatching operation at the receiver side for the message signal, for the information reading signal, it performs the spreading operation of the interference signal, jamming signal, at the receiving side. Because apart from the signal BT, the second signal which has been obtained over here is CT into IT. So if IT is the interference signal, jamming signal, which is unwanted signal and which you don't want to affect the decision-making process, so that has been taken care of by multiplying this one IT with another signal, I mean this code signal CT. And since you are multiplying IT with the CT, it will spread the bandwidth of IT so that if the output of the modulator, I mean this multiplier, which is a part of the demodulator, if the output of this is being fed to the input of a low pass filter or integrator, then eventually it will filter out this component CT into IT. Because the bandwidth of CT into IT is much, much larger as compared to the bandwidth of BT. So the integrator output will eventually reflect the information regarding BT, and depending upon the value sampled at time t is equal to tb, we have to decide whether the symbol, actual symbol transmitted, was 1 or 0. If it is greater than 0, the decision will be made in favor of 1. And if it is less than 0, then the decision will be made in favor of 0. And in some exceptional cases where the value of this sampled signal V is exactly equal to 0, then the receiver can make a random guess either in favor of 0 or 1. But ultimately, it will not affect the overall bit error rate of the system. And this is all about the split spectrum modulation and which forms the backbone of the code division multiple access of digital communication system. So in case of code division multiple access, the entire bandwidth is being assigned to all the users, and all of them will transmit the information. So very briefly, let me just tell you the fundamental notion about the code division multiple access, or CDMA. So you have a number of transmitters. So we do have a number of transmitters, and we do have a number of receivers. Just like in a mobile communication system, we have a number of transmitters and we have a number of receivers, and they are communicating with each other over a common channel. A number of communication is being taken place over there. Now, all of them are communicating simultaneously over a duration from say zero to say some t dashed. They are communicating simultaneously, and they are also using the same channel. So they are using the same time slot. They are also using the same bandwidth allocated to them. So obvious question is that whether there is a possibility of interference or not. So whenever transmitter one is communicating with receiver one and transmitter two is communicating with receiver two, whether there is any provision of interference between them or not. So any chance of interference can be avoided if we invoke the notion of this code division multiple access. So in case of code division multiple access, all of them, all the communications are being done in same time slot using the same bandwidth, transmission bandwidth, but each of them are provided with a separate code. So for this one, for T1R1, so they are supplied with the code say C1. For T2R2, they are supplied with the code C2. For T3R3, they are supplied with the code say C3. And these codes are orthogonal to each other. So whenever the receiver, this receiver one, R1, is receiving the information, so the signal may come from the other transmitters as well, from T1, T2, T3, T4 as well. But in the receiver R1, we have the code C1 only. So the receiver one output is nothing but the actual input, the desired input that is obtained from T1 and the other components as well, which are obtained from T2, T3, T4, and so on. Now, if the codes are made in such a way that they are orthogonal with each other, that means the communication from T1 to R1 by means of code C1 will not affect the communication from T2 to R2 by means of code C2, then this entire thing can be done. I mean, this entire communication can be accomplished without any further interference. So each of these communication setup, they are not separated by time instant. They are not separated by the frequency requirement or frequency spectrum. Rather, they are separated, they are segregated by virtue of the codes. Each of the communication setup are equipped with a code, and these codes are orthogonal in nature. And because of this orthogonality, the corresponding interference from the one to the other is negligibly small. And this forms the basis of code division multiple access, or in short, it is known as CDMA. And apart from CDMA, if I consider GSM kind of mobile communication system, here you see that in case of GSM, all the communications are being carried out simultaneously, so they are using the same time slot, but the available bandwidth to the system is being segregated into different users. So if I have an overall bandwidth of say W, then this W is being segregated amongst the different set of communication. So that's what is known as a frequency division multiplexing or frequency division multiplexes. So all of them are using the same time slot, but since they are using the different frequency components or different frequency bands, F1 for first communication, F2 for the next one, F3 for the third one, and if there is no overlapping between F1 and F2 and F2 and F3, what I mean to say is that suppose we have a bandwidth like this, is the total bandwidth available, and these are segregated. Suppose this one is F1, this one is F2, this one is F3. So depending upon the requirement, the service provider, they are just segregating, or they are just this is the total bandwidth, that is W, and depending upon the requirement, and this has been divided into such non-overlapping frequency band, and each of the communication is being taken place in any of the frequency bands assigned to the particular subscriber. So since here all of them are communicating with each other simultaneously but using a different band of frequency, so it is known as a frequency division multiplexes, and which forms the basis of GSM communication system. And for CDMA, we employ the notion of split spectrum modulation. So with this, I would like to conclude our discussion on split spectrum modulation system.